there was a significant direct investment by Singapore. When, again, at a time when many developing countries, and in fact, Singapore invested, but they also welcomed foreign direct investment, foreign multinational corporations. And even at that time, I would say, unfortunately, a lot of developing countries and newly independent countries view multinationals as a vestige of colonialism and tended to have a love-hate relationship with them, not the open embrace and trying to see how to maximize the benefits of their presence. So, I mean, that is something I just, it just struck the note when I saw it. So the government of Singapore at that time sought to adopt measures to improve the investment climate, something that we continue to do here after 50 years or 60 years of independence. New laws at that time moderated labor costs by limiting some tactics of trade unions. I wanted to mention that because sometimes, you know, has to be a balance between individual freedom and activity and what is the national good. Somebody has to moderate that balance, otherwise you'll have extreme behaviors and you may not get a result. But even at that early stage, you had free convertibility of the Singapore dollar. You know, we did that maybe, I think, in the late 1990s. I'm speaking here about the 70s. So you're talking about the head start that a small country like Singapore would have had. They also managed the exchange rates very close to market rates. And when you do that, you don't really have a lot of leakage of foreign exchange out of your system or stockpiling abroad and all the ills that we sometimes complain about. So that if the established rate or the actual rate is close to what the true market rate is, there is no incentive for anybody to stockpile foreign reserve outside the country. Tariffs and duties on imports and exports were set at very low levels, even at that time. I mean, fortunately, we did have gone ahead with the common external tariff with CARICOM. I mean, we've been doing something, but again, the pace has been somewhat, slow. As I said earlier, the Ministry of Finance took equity stakes in some local companies and provided co-financing on some large projects. And in that way, some industries, electrical machinery, petroleum products, construction, etc., grew. Now, one of the things that I noticed was some of these government, what they call government-linked companies, or GLCs, they played a critical role in the development, the early development of the country. So, as it says, nothing is really wrong if the primary vehicle for funds and national development in a small developing country is the government. Somebody has to do the investment or encourage the investment on behalf of the country or the people. And that led to certain investments in areas that grew. An example, for instance, was in the shipbuilding and repair industry. We also have a similar kind of geography as Singapore. We are an island state. We have some fairly good sheltered harbors. They had a superb, maybe one of the best natural harbors in the world that they have capitalized on and grew to become maybe the busiest port in the world. But we also were not without advantages. In fact, the Point Fortin harbor is a natural deepwater harbor that ships now LNG. But also, whole Gulf of Paria is a protected area. It needs a little bit of work in terms of dredging or what have you, but it is there. And it is there to be optimized, especially where we are located between North and South America. Few countries in the world are located as fortunately as we are, straddling North and South America, in the middle of most of the shipping lanes in the Western Hemisphere, tremendous amount of traffic passing our door, and with deep water harbors, Chagaramas, Port of Spain, Point Lisas, Point Fortin, Galeota, we need to optimize those opportunities and those natural advantages. And some that led in Singapore to using the location and the natural harbor as a critical, maybe the most, I would say the most single asset of the country. Because from that locational advantage and that deep water harbor, it spawned shipbuilding industry. It spawned petroleum, oil and petrochemical refining industry. It became the center serving that's Southeast Asia region. But as I said, the original advantages were no different to what Trinidad and Tobago currently possess. Now, some of these, what is called government linked companies, were joint ventures with foreign companies. For instance, the Singapore Refining Company. It was a joint venture with Singapore Oil Refining Industry. It was within Caltex and BP and the government. Now, the reason why I mentioned that, again, I know we've been struggling with a conceptual issue of whether we should have a joint venture partner with PetroTren and what have you, so I just threw that outside there, you know, in terms of the efficiency and in terms of where we want to go with an industry. In many of these cases, the government provided initial capital but did not offer any other support or protection, so that the government-linked companies were forced to compete on the same terms as their foreign rivals. Very important. I think we continue to recognize that without competition allows all of us to set a new high, a new standard of equilibrium. It forces us to perform better. We have no choice because the very, very nature of competition, it forces us to try our best. Monetary policy since in their independence emphasized very low inflation, maintenance of low inflation. As I said, they maintain the convertibility of the single currency. Since 1973, the currency was allowed to float, a very small island state. Government revenues were turned positive. The current account balance in the mid-80s and government revenues exceeded spending, resulting in budget surpluses for all but 1 year of the 1980s and 1990s. So can you imagine that in the 80s and 90s, for 20 long years, just 1 year, there was not a budget surplus. Now, I agree that modern economic theory, especially the newfound econometrics, speaks about having a slight pull so that you always want a bit of inflation to push demand and to prime the system. All I'm saying, maybe this balanced nature of a budget at that time was easier to manage and relevant. Now with quantitative easing and all these more sophisticated financial tools, I don't know how responsive or, it would be in this kind of global situation if everybody is priming their pump and you try to maintain very low, a more mundane, stable system, you may be out of the game. But it's something, the point I'm making here is very early, for each period of time, there are certain policies that may be relevant and that you max out. When the environment changes, of course, there are new policies and programs that one needs to adopt. In these early times, policies and programs that gave the country a competitive advantage were pursued. And we, as I say, we had similar opportunities, but we didn't get far off the starting block. Singapore, just like us, located in the main Europe and Far East shipping route. And of course, as we know, Singapore has become one of the busiest ports in the world. The amount of traffic. In fact, it is the largest container port in the world, if I am not incorrect. And as I only remember, the back of your head is 697 square kilometers we're talking about. The government, this is an interesting point, the government viewed the port as its lifeline, devoting as much capital to its to the facilities as it could. The result was a perennial state of expansion and upgrading. Can you imagine that? There was a constant, once it identified the port as its strategic asset, there was a perpetual state of expansion and upgrading. Something that we again need a lesson to learn or something we need to think about. In 1972, ahead of the curve, Singapore built the first regional container terminal since 1972 and introduced 24-hour berthing service. In 1972, Singapore had 24-hour berthing service. I think except for Point Lisas, up to now, we do not have a 24-hour berthing service in the other ports of the island. Now, if you have 24-hour berthing service, immediately your capacity doubles or triples overnight with the same net asset. And not only that, if the shipping lines know that you're a 24-hour port, in fact, many shipping lines avoid your port if they know that you are not a 24-hour port because they're not sure when that vessel is going to arrive. And if it arrives out of the window, it has to wait maybe 15, 18, 24 hours. And as you know, some of these vessels, the mileage rate might be $50,000 a day. So that it is a very expensive decision that they make if you are not running a 24-hour port. So it's something, again, that we need to think about and a lesson from Singapore. We hear horror stories even now about even clearing a barrel, much more a container, you know? So, but all these are really economic issues that are, they are symptoms of much more fundamental issues that we need to address if we want to get our show on the road. Similarly, again, the old British naval dockyards were converted to a ship repair center, which grew rapidly. Trinidad has a similar advantage. I don't know if anybody old enough to remember these 100 dockyards in Chagaramas. A facility that so long ago had a capacity to service and to dry dock major vessels. And we kind of lose that capacity. Instead of expanding on that repair and maintenance capability, but I must say, and again with vision, I don't know if it's coming from the minister, we have a maritime campus now in Chagaramas trying to rebuild that industry. But we need to rebuild it more quickly than the pace we are going. Because by 2015, the end of 2015 or 16, the Panama Canal, the upgraded Panama Canal will be up and running. And if we don't grasp the opportunity, someone else will. It's not going to stay there and wait until we are good and ready to provide the necessary training and infrastructure and capacity to access the opportunity. So that we need to quickly respond to that opportunity that is facing us. Similarly, as I said, and it's a similar situation we have in Trinidad and Tobago. Capital-intensive industries also grew. Singapore promoted the expansion of the former British Navy refueling facilities. I think I can't recall earlier if Dr. Professor Tan mentioned the British pullout, and of course that gave a significant rise in unemployment. You had 70,000 to 80,000 people with that in that servicing that base, but Singapore marketed that use facility to the multinational oil corporations that were interested in doing searching for oil in Indonesia and Borneo and other countries in the region. A similar thing we see happening here, where Suriname, as we know, there have been developments in Suriname, in Guyana, in Brazil, in Barbados, and we are sitting with all this knowledge and know-how in the right location, with the right history and the right know-how, and we need to pounce on it. You know, maybe pounce is a strong word because I think we're crawling towards it. And now Singapore is one of the largest petroleum refining centers in Asia. Again, no petroleum, mind you, but it's the largest petroleum refining center in Asia. And it's a complementary thing. Now you have refining and you have port facilities. And at the same time, and even if that was not enough, other sectors of the economy grew rapidly. I'm talking here about financial services, transportation, communication. So it's not that they were singularly focused on port activities or petroleum refining. They were able to do more than one thing at one time, you know? And it's something, again, that although I must say, I mean, doing this research, I must say that lately there has been what I call a profusion of directed activity in the economy and in different sectors and in different clusters that I think is extremely promising. I'll speak to that a little later. I don't know if anybody else down the timeline arrived at 1985. Remember that recession we had in 1985? In fact, we had a change of government in 86 because of the recession in 85. We had the, a new government coming in Trinidad because the recession was so deep. But it was a recession that affected other economies of the world. Just like in Trinidad, there was a sharp recession in Singapore. But interestingly happened, a sharp rise in unemployment. The recession was partly explained by the international oil market. We got a direct hit because we were oil economy even then. However, but Singapore would have been affected because they were refining oil, they were transporting oil, they were associated with the oil industry. But a high-level economic committee formed in 1985 from both public and private managers concluded that not all the reasoning had to do with the international oil market. Much of it had to do with structural deficiencies in the economy. And that accounted for a larger portion of the decline. And if you identify there were structural deficiencies in the economy, then you need to do something about it. You need to remedy it. And this is exactly what they did. Corrective measures were instituted. And by the next year, there was a turnaround. Over time, the focus was shifted to diversification of the economy and to automation. In the meantime, financial services, the other arms of the business clusters continued to grow, such that Singapore, even at that time, became the third most important financial center in Asia after Tokyo and Hong Kong. Now again, and I think it is very well directed, we are looking at Port of Spain and Trinidad being a financial center of the Caribbean and Latin America. I think it is well positioned. We need to make it happen. We need to accelerate the work so that Trinidad, in fact, it has all the advantages. It has a, and I will speak to that, Trinidad, in fact, has a significant financial services sector. Our GDP, we have 11% of our GDP is accounted for by the financial services sector. And there are about 50,000 knowledge workers in the Trinidad and Tobago that is working in that banking and financial sector. But we have not migrated much from banking and some of these simple activities. And we need to do that if we are to be a true financial sector. We need to move to currency trading, to the stock market, to asset management, to other activities that are higher up the value chain and the value added chain in the industry and in all the sectors and industries that we want to target. And I think we are targeting the right industry. Because if you look at the parallels, as you will see, we are targeting the similar clusters as Singapore, and the clusters that hold the most promise for us, because just like Singapore, one needs to target sectors and clusters where you have the potential for a strategic advantage. If it is in maritime, it's because of your locational advantage that no one can take away from you. Or your geographical position, that again, no one can take away from you. So there are certain inherent advantages that each island state or each state has that it needs to optimize or maximize on. And because we are almost kind of a reflection of Singapore on this side of the world, many of the clusters would be similar in nature because the forces, the economic forces and the other social and institutional factors are similar in nature. So that's why lessons from Singapore is so vital for Trinidad and Tobago in my view. As I said, Singapore became the third most important financial sector after Tokyo and Hong Kong. The kind of names we're talking about. You know, not after Borneo or Sumatra or one of those countries. Singapore Port, as I said, became one of the most efficient and busiest ports in the world. Similarly, it's oil insulation. In fact, its airport, the Changi Airport, was voted the world's best airport for several consecutive years. Best airport, not in terms only of the amount of traffic through it, but the quality of service. Service quality is something that we would want to hear more and more about. We know that one of the inputs, developed countries, one of my professor remarked that the quality of service in developed countries in both the private and the public sector is on par. So you make your own judgment. Singapore's public administration was increasingly seen as a global role model. The administration was as a benchmark for how administration should run. And hear this bit. Government-linked firms were managed differently than in most other countries, with professional boards of directors and expectations that they make a profit. So they need to run efficiently and professionally, and they, whether it's a government link or a private enterprise, they need to have their profit motive and a competitive spirit. I think, again, looking at the period 1991 to 2008, again, I think Professor Tan touched on it. The new government at that time was a new government by Goh Chok Tong, the second elected prime minister, and quickly adopted a new plan called the Next Lap. And the plan listed long-term social and economic goals, including plans to improve infrastructure, expand educational opportunities, build research institutes to support companies bent on expanding in the world markets, and created an advisory body of Singaporeans living abroad. You know, we have a diaspora second to none, I would say, in Trinidad and Tobago, because for a very long time, our peoples have gone to the North America and Europe for opportunity, and they have excelled in their areas. And I'm sure they're ready and willing to assist the development process. So we need to tap into that, because there's a wealth of ideas and energy there. But the Prime Minister opined at the launch of his plan, I quote here, "We must never forget the basics. We have to stay united, work hard, save, look after each other, be quick to seize opportunities, and be vigilant. No one owes us a living. We have to earn it." And this is in 1991. And words of that should be written in stone, you know, in each building and enterprise. The plan, there was a plan to set a goal, a lofty goal of achieving a US level per capita standard of living by 2013. As we know, by 2030, I think somebody misread the thing, they thought it was 2013 and they achieved it. Instead of 2030, they did it in 2013. Somebody heard, the audience heard incorrectly, clearly. and it took off. During the 1990s, the Singaporean government implemented a number of policy initiatives following that vision. The Economic Development Board, and I must say we have an Economic Development Board, so again, we are following many of the structures that Singapore adopted. They set out to attract new investments in high value-added industries like electronics, information technology, communications, petrochemicals. Manufacturing firms were given incentives to engage in activities beyond manufacturing, then more value added. In fact, the EDB, the Economic Development Board, set the goal of attracting 500 world-class companies to carry out their substantial headquarter activity in Singapore by 2010. I think they have achieved that already. Can you imagine 500 world-class enterprises having their headquarters in a country? The amount of economic activity that we are speaking about, and high-quality economic activity, because you're talking about the boards and CEOs and top management and the amount of traffic and activity that takes place. In addition, I think, again, Professor Tan alluded to that, a program, Thinking Schools, Learning Nation, was launched to transform the education system to foster creativity, independent thinking, and problem solving. And of course, that required comprehensive reforms in school management processes, the tough work, systems, and structures to pave the way for subsequent changes in curricula and pedagogy. Research centers and advanced training programs will launch in a number of areas. Again, if you look at our research contribution, the percentage that we are allocating to research activities, you know, someone told me recently, you know, where is the ROI on research? It will come, it's just a longer gestation period. We need to do it. We need to allocate the resources. It's not going to happen overnight, but we need to do it today so that tomorrow we can see the results of it. The Government Computer Board announced a plan for the development of information technology, IT 2000, since 2000. Significant investments were made in integrated service digital network technology, fiber optics, etc., which we know and we understand. It's not that our people don't know. We need those tools to support advanced information and communication technologies. We need to put it in place. We can't be hobbled by a mediocre information in architecture or infrastructure. That is now the lifeblood of most organizations and countries. I think the professor again alluded to one of the things, an ambitious plan to turn the entire downtown Marina Bay area into an environment for businesses, tourists, residents, and to become one of the, it became one of the most visible symbols of economic transformation. I think we have been trying that. We have stalled a little bit in it, but we need to get back on it because the physical space of a country is very important to uplift the mental space of citizens. You know, we see that even in our educational system. Schools that have superior physical space produce better results. Even with the same quality of input, it's a natural human thing. If your employees are comfortable and they like the environment, they will produce more. They want to stay longer on the job. And we need to address those issues. I will turn quickly because I saw my timekeeper, she gave me the signal. I just want to point out that just like Trinidad and Tobago, Singapore identified clusters, business clusters, economic clusters. And we are doing it also, and it's interesting that many of the clusters are similar to what we have targeted. So it, I think, given the basis of the location of our countries, the infrastructure, the size of the country, and on our inherent advantages, I think even the choice of those clusters, there's a good parallel and it can resonate with us. And we need to move forward aggressively with those clusters. I'm talking here about transportation, logistics, finance, information technology, maritime services, tourism. All those are things that we have identified. Culture and the creative arts, energy and energy services. So the clusters are there. They have been identified and adopted and by the administration, by the government. I don't think anybody now, current administration or past administration, disputes that these clusters are relevant and suitable and appropriate for Trinidad and Tobago. I think that those disputes have been ironed out. We agree in the main that these are clusters that will take us where we want to go. So we need to actually implement and deepen the cluster and get results from the clusters and work into it. Petrochemical cluster, we have a petrochemical point leases cluster for the longest while. We have not been growing it as we should and deepening it and moving it to the next stage of progress. It's something that we need to do. Again, I refer in the Caribbean, I think our financial services industry is second to none. We just need to now migrate it to a higher level and more value added and get into the more sophisticated activities in the financial industry. It's similar with the maritime industry. In fact, the government had formed the Neptune Oriental Lines, NOL, and that is now one of the largest shipping lines in the world. Again, looking at the size of the country, the space of the country. So we are into the right areas. One of the areas that we have not really gotten in a significant way that they have done is pharmaceuticals and biopharmaceuticals. But I guess it's because they have been much far further ahead in their research and in their life sciences and in their biomedical research so that it can spawn industries in this area. Tourism. I was very pleased to hear the push into tourism, although it came with a few little wrinkles, as you said, with your exotic, is it exotic hotels? Integrated facilities. But the fact of the matter is, at the end of the day, if you're looking to stimulate economic activity and you have control of your activities, all these are cluster activities that are required to grow the industry. Your facilities, there's a multiplicity of clients that come to your facility, and you need to cater to their needs once it's legitimate activities. Tourism, we have our location, our natural advantages, our weather. It's superb for a first-class tourism industry, and in fact, some of that is taking place in the region, in Barbados, in St. Lucia, and other regions. Not just that, Trinidad has the capacity for a more value-added type of tourism, medical tourism, ecotourism. We have been putting a superb sports infrastructure, sports tourism. So the education tourism, as we see, we have a second university. We are trying to expand with the help of Dr. Tang and his colleagues. We should be able to attract students from the region and build on education tourism. We already passed our national objective of 60% at the tertiary level. So clearly, and our birth rates are declining, but we have the institutional infrastructure. How are we going to fill all these spaces? We have to aggressively promote educational tourism from the region and from the Latin American region, so that not only the Caribbean region, but the hinterland. And why is it now that we can't get to a competitive state where we can attract students from North America and Europe? As Dr. Chan said, we need to promote the exchange of students and faculty. But when that happens, it also brings you to the attention of the student community worldwide is an integrated community, and we need to, we can promote that. So we have the infrastructure, we are building the infrastructure, and it's available. As we saw, Singapore attracted more than a dozen foreign universities, as we heard, including MIT, Cornell, Wharton, Chicago, INSEAD, others, to come to their shows and to set up shop. So that I'm running out of time, so I will take one more minute of your time. I wanted to say, I just wanted to repeat the point that our provost made earlier. One of the objectives of the latest Economic Strategies Committee that was mentioned earlier, the goal is the highly skilled people, their target, innovative economy, distinctive global city. And the bywords, we must be a vibrant and distinctive global city, open and diverse, the best place to grow and reach out to a rising Asia, and a home that provides an outstanding quality of life for our people. And how to achieve that? Three main priorities. Boost skills in every job. Deepen corporate capabilities to seize opportunities. And in this case, make Singapore a distinctive global city and an enduring home. No reason why we can substitute Singapore for Trinidad and Tobago. Quickly, I think, I know I've been searching for some answers. Sometimes I think because we have had oil and gas resources in abundance for so long, maybe the natural resource curse kicked in, maybe the Dutch disease kicked in, and you know, there's a lot of theory about that, where we don't grow as fast as our less endowed brethren because we focus more on distributive activities than in actually growing the pie. So a lot of the focus and challenge and discussion is how do we equitably share the pie as opposed to how do we enlarge the pie. And that is something that could well be that we have you know, suffered from. Now that the harsh realities are on our doorsteps, we need to pick up and accelerate our activities, which I think is already, the plans are already there. The diversification plans, the Ministry of Planning and Development. In fact, I was reading a very interesting document that they outlined, which I said, but you know, all the answers are here. You know, the thought processes are there. We need to, sector by sector, cluster by cluster, take it and implement and action it in an aggressive manner. So, thank you very much for your attention. I have a lot more to say, but I'll sit at another forum one of these days. But thank you for your attention.
Let's give Dr. Rampasad again another round of applause. Gave a very exhaustive presentation, very detailed, where Trinidad and Tobago, we are so similar to Singapore, like we are twins, but I think the difference is we are dissimilar twins, clearly. What we'll do now is, I spoke to the organizer, VP Burhai, and he says we can go to 3:15. So with your indulgence, we'll go with that. We have the question and answer session now. Now, I want to just start by saying this is a question and answer session. So let us just have speeches. All too often, you know, during these sessions, people get up and make speeches. Oh, that's great. We'll invite you to speak at another time. But those of you who are interested, please ask your questions. Make them precise as possible so we can, you know, maximize, you know, the returns on these distinguished gentlemen. Secondly, it's a very complex topic. You know, governance and economies, it's a complex system, and those of you who study complex systems will know that the slightest changes bring about a lot of